All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Christ the Lord became obedient unto death, even death on a cross. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned in thought and word and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We pray you of your mercy, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, look graciously, we pray, on this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed and given into the hands of sinners and to suffer death upon the cross, who now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John. After Jesus had spoken these words, he went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to a place where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, because Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas brought a detachment of soldiers, together with police from the chief priests and the Pharisees, And they came there with lanterns and with torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to happen to him, came forward asking them, "Whom are you looking for?" They answered, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus replied, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they stepped back and fell to the ground. Again, Jesus asked them, "Whom are you looking for?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. So if you are looking for me, let these men go." This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "I did not lose a single one of those whom you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword back into its sheath. Am I not to drink the cup that the Father has given to me?" So the soldiers, their officer, and the Jewish police arrested Jesus and bound him. First, they took him to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jews that it was better to have one person die for the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he went with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest. But Peter was standing outside at the gate. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out and spoke to the woman who guarded the gate and brought Peter in. The woman said to Peter, "You are not also one of this man's disciples, are you?" Peter said, "I am not." Now the slaves and the police had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing around it and warming themselves. Peter also was standing with them and warming himself. Then the high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. Jesus answered, "I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple where all the Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Ask those who heard what I said to them. They know what I said." When Jesus had said this, one of the police standing nearby struck him on the face, saying, "Is that how you answer the high priest?" Jesus answered, "If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?" Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They asked him, "You are not also one of his disciples, are you?" He denied it and said, "I am not." One of the slaves of the high priest, the relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked, "Did I not see you in the garden with him?" Again, Peter denied it. And at that moment, the cock crowed. Then they took Jesus from Caiaphas to Pilate's headquarters. It was early in the morning. They themselves did not enter the headquarters so as to avoid ritual defilement and to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate went out to them and said, "What accusation do you bring against this man?" They answered, "If this man were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you." Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law." The Jews replied, "We are not permitted to put anyone to death." This was to fulfill what Jesus had said when he indicated the kind of death he was to die. Then Pilate entered the headquarters again and summoned Jesus and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" Peter replied, "I am not." Pilate replied, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate asked him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I'm king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." Pilate asked him, "What is truth?" After he had said this, he went out to the Jews again and told them, "I find no case against him. But you have a custom that I release someone for you at the Passover. Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?" They shouted in reply, "Not this man, but Barabbas." Now Barabbas was a bandit. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. And the soldiers wove a crown of thorns and put it on his head. And they dressed him in a purple robe. They kept coming up to him saying, "Hail, King of the Jews," and striking him on the face. Pilate went out again and said to them, "Look, I am bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no case against him." So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, "Here is the man." When the chief priests and the police saw him, they shouted, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no case against him." The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die, because he has claimed to be the Son of God." Now when Pilate heard this, he was more afraid than ever. He entered his headquarters again and asked Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. Pilate therefore said to him, "Do you refuse to speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you and power to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You would have no power over me unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin." From then on, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out, "If you release this man, you are no friend of the emperor. Everyone who claims to be a king sets himself against the emperor." When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus outside and sat on the judge's bench at a place called the Stone Pavement, or in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation for the Passover, and it was about noon. He said to the Jews, "Here is your king." They cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate asked them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but the emperor." Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross by himself, he went out to a place that is called the place of the skull, which in Hebrew is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with two others, one on either side, with Jesus between them. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. The chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write the King of the Jews, but this man said, 'I am the King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier. And they also took his tunic. Now the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top. So they said to one another, let us not tear it, but cast lots to see who will get it." This was to fulfill what the scripture says, "They divided my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots." And that is what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, "I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was standing there, so they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Since it was the day of preparation, the Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because that Sabbath was a day of great solemnity. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified men broken and the bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified so that you may also believe. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth. These things occurred so that the scripture might be fulfilled, "None of his bones shall be broken." And again, another passage of scripture says, "They will look on the one whom they have pierced." After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, though a secret one because of his fear of the Jews, asked Pilate to let him take away the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him permission. So he came and removed his body. Nicodemus, who had at first come to Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and wrapped it with the spices in linen cloths, according to the burial custom of the Jews. Now there was a garden in the place where he was crucified, and in the garden there was a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. And so, because it was the Jewish day of preparation and the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. I used to play hockey with a group of clergy who would get together every Monday for a game up in Tavistock. There were Mennonite pastors as part of this group, Christian Reformed, Missouri Synod Lutherans. There was some United players, Anglicans, Baptist, Pentecostal. Argoli was a Roman Catholic priest. It really was an ecumenical kind of affair. And in the dressing room getting ready for the game, let's just say it wasn't your typical hockey change room banter. It's a rare hockey change room where the talk is all about God. Every week, someone would inevitably ask, "So what did everyone preach on yesterday?" And that's all it would take to get a lively and sometimes heated conversation started. I will always remember this one particular day. We were lacing up our skates, and someone in the room said, "Did you hear about that poor kid Ryan and his dad?" Turns out Ryan had been diagnosed with leukemia when he was only 1 year old. And for the next 3 years, the whole family gave everything they had to give to fight cancer. They would make the long drive from their home near Stratford to London for treatments. His parents missed a lot of work to care for Ryan. You name it, the whole family made sacrifices. They made sacrifices in their effort to beat cancer. When it came time for Ryan to start kindergarten, he couldn't go because he was too sick. And so while all the other kids his age were heading off to school for the first time, Ryan was heading back to the hospital for the next round of chemo. But the day finally came when Ryan completed his final cancer treatment. And his family, they threw a great big backyard celebration with a cake that said, "I kicked cancer's butt." The following September, Ryan started grade one. And he wanted to play hockey like his older brothers. He wanted to do everything his older brothers did. And in the fall, Ryan got the go-ahead from his doctors to play in the area league. And what made it even better, his dad was going to be the assistant coach on his team. In February, his dad cheered him on as Ryan scored a hat trick at an early morning game. But then, just before 10 a.m. on a snowy drive back home, Ryan's dad lost control of his truck and collided with a large feed truck. Both Ryan and his dad were killed in that accident. Can you imagine? You actually kick cancer's butt, only to die in a car accident. After sitting there listening to that story, after that period, that long, awkward silence, letting the horrendous details soak in, one of the clergy in our dressing room broke the silence and said, "Where is our God of love now?" I had never seen that locker room so quiet. I had never seen this group of guys at such a loss for words like they were in that moment. Where is our God of love now? Why does God allow this kind of suffering in the world? That has to be, without a doubt, the biggest, most common objection to belief in God. It's certainly a reason why so many people who have lived through tragedies and loss in their lives, it's certainly a big reason why many people have lost their faith. Because if there really is a God, then He would do something about all of the pain and the suffering in our world. If there really is a God, He wouldn't have let this happen. The story of the cross, our Christian story, the very cross before which we gather on Good Friday. It is supposed to be our answer to those who ask, where is your God of love? But even from within the story that is supposed to be the source of our hope, even from within the story, you can hear that question being asked again and again and again by the religious and the political leaders, by the crowds, by the disciples, even by Jesus himself. Where is your God of love now? The betrayal, the abandonment, the arrest. Where is your God of love? The mocking, the taunting, the ridicule. Where is your God of love? The beating, the abuse, the flogging. Where is your God of love? The lashings, the crown of thorns, hanging from a tree. Where is your God of love? On Good Friday, the darkness finally wins. Or so it seems. I want you to think for a minute, if you will. I want you to think back to the first Sunday of Advent, when one precocious purple candle threw back its shoulders and took a deep breath. The first light of our Advent wreath, with one small crackle, it chased away a whole world of darkness that could not overcome it. In that moment, I don't know about you, but in that moment, hope stirred within me. Hope that promised that a Savior was coming. Hope that promised us that God is indeed with us. At the second week of Advent, a second candle began to shine in the darkness. And soon there were three, and then four, and then a fifth candle on Christmas Eve. And soon every candle wanted in on the act. Think of a tradition we have on Christmas Eve when the lights are dimmed and one by one candles are all lit throughout the building. Think of all the lights shining in the darkness as we sing Silent Night together. Then beyond that, a bright star joins the chorus at Epiphany, and by the time we reach our celebration of the Transfiguration, the light of the world truly glowed in the dark. And in that moment, we know where to find our God of love. But now comes today. On Good Friday, the light disappears. The light of God's love appears to be snuffed out once and for all. Today is a day where we are left to wrestle with the darkness once again. Even though we have gotten used to the light being with us, even though we prefer light to darkness, that does not mean that there are not times in our lives when we are not left to be haunted by the shadows. Today is such a day. From noon until 3, we will watch as the earth grows dark. The cross will eclipse our assumptions about God. The cross will reveal our uncertainty. Maybe even our anger and our bitterness toward God for all the suffering in our world and in our lives, for all the suffering and the pain that we experience. But the cross will also show us the heart of the one who is hanging upon it. So where is our God of love? Where do we find God in the story of the cross? Where do we find God in our world full of pain and suffering? We find God in exactly the same place where others are pointing to and saying, see, there is no God. God was there in the betrayal, the abandonment, and the arrest. God is found on the receiving end of the mocking, the taunting, and the ridicules. Our God is the one receiving the lashings and wearing the crown of thorns, and the one who is dying on a tree. The cross does not deny the reality of death. The cross does not deny the reality of pain and suffering. In fact, the story of the cross reinforces the fact that we are living in a broken and sometimes cruel world. It does not deny the fact that pain and suffering, evil and death are a very real part of our world. It doesn't deny any of that. What the cross does do, it denies the finality of death. It denies that the pain and the suffering and all the brokenness that we are currently experiencing, it denies that this is the way it's always going to be. The cross denies the way things are and makes possible the resurrection of hope for a better tomorrow. When Jesus died the horrible death that he died on the cross, he showed himself to be at one with the suffering of humanity. So when people ask, why doesn't our God do something about the pain and the suffering in our world? Our God has done something. God has entered fully into that suffering. The mystery of our faith is this. The mystery of our faith is that somehow because Jesus died on the cross, he has become completely one with the suffering of humanity. Somehow because Jesus died on the cross, we can know and be assured that Jesus is fully present with us in our own pain and in our own suffering that we sometimes experience. We can be assured that God was fully present with Ryan and his dad the day of that accident. Emmanuel, a name given to Jesus. Emmanuel means God is with us. The cross before which we stand on this day makes it clear that God's love for us is so strong and so deep that God is with us in all circumstances of our lives. And so may you, as you stand at the foot of the cross this Good Friday, surrounded by so much suffering, may you, out of the most terrible and ugly reality of Jesus' death on the cross, may you come to a deeper vision that your God loves you so much that he chooses to enter into your suffering and wants nothing more than to make his home in you, so that in your life, no matter what is going on, so that in your life you might experience a new strength, the peace and joy that can only come from the loving, tender presence of God. So where is our God of love now? Today he's the one hanging on that cross, so that tomorrow hope might be resurrected and light shine from the darkness once more.
When they crucified my Lord, were you there? When they crucified my Lord, oh, sometimes it it causes me to tremble. Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they nailed him to the tree? Were you there when they nailed him to the tree? Sometimes it causes me to tremble. Were you there when they nailed him to the tree? Were you there when they pierced him in the side? Were you there when they pierced him in the side? Sometimes it causes me to tremble. Were you there when they pierced him in the side? Were you there when the sun refused to shine? Were you there when the sun refused to shine? Sometimes it causes me to tremble. Were you there when the sun refused to shine? Were you there when they laid him in the tomb? Were you there when they laid him in the tomb? Sometimes it causes me to tremble.